You are, of course, the head of the Department of Player Safety. I'd love to know, what is it that you guys do? I know you have a representative watching every single game. There's no need for teams to say, hey, can you guys review the video?
Yeah, people hear a lot about the war room in Toronto, the operations room. They do all the goal reviews and officiating reviews. We have the same thing going on here right in Midtown Manhattan. We've got a whole team dedicated to just player safety, supplementary discipline, on-ice infractions. We take a look at every single play of every single game. They used to send in the videotape, right? And that tells you how old it was because it's back in the videotape era. We don't do that anymore. We've got a whole team dedicated to this stuff, so we're monitoring every game.
Now, of course, you're in charge of player safety, but is part and parcel with that to make the game as attractive as possible for the fans?
Yeah, I think the two go hand in hand. It really dawned on me when I took over the department, you know, the decisions that we make, that I make, they have a direct impact on the game, and we want those to be for the better. We're trying to protect the sport in general. We're trying to protect the players on the ice. We're trying to protect the integrity of the game, and we like to think that when we make a decision, it affects the way the players play the game. And like I said, we like physical hockey. We like good, clean hitting. We just don't like when it's over the line, and that's what we're there for.
You've devoted so much time to eliminating dirty hits, to eliminating slashing. Talk about some of the key accomplishments so far in your tenure.
Slashing was actually an interesting one. It was brought about by the keepers of the game, our general managers and everyone else in it. Try to free up some of our skilled players and allow them to create more offense. We've had scoring up. As everyone could say, the offense has spiked since then. And the game's in a good spot, I think.
What are your recollections of Ron Hextall? Like, how would you legislate some of the tactics, we'll say, that he used back in the day?
Man, that's an interesting one. I'm kind of glad I don't have to deal with that. Ron was an exceptionally talented goaltender, as we all know, but obviously very fiery and emotional, and that's why he was so good. I think of Billy Smith as well, and guys like that. There's some crazy things that happened in the history of our sport. Obviously, we look through a different lens these days, and there's less of those types of antics that go on, whether it's wild stick swings or extreme acts of aggression. We're trying to cut those out of the game.
Let's talk about fighting. There was a notion back in the day that fans showed up to watch fighting. But now, if you look at the NHL arenas, there's less fighting. You guys to play to 95% capacity during the regular season. Over 100% capacity in the postseason. Was that a myth that fans really craved fighting?
I don't think it was a myth at all. I think a lot of people loved that aspect of the game. Certainly got them out of their seats from time to time. And it was an exciting part of the sport, but at the same time, I think we've kind of progressed from there. I think, as you said, there's been really no rules to take fighting out of the game. It's kind of happened naturally. There's a lot more of an appetite for the high-end skill in our game and focus on that. I think the teams are just built differently these days, quite honestly. Roster spots are more and more valuable. We have a salary cap institute in the sport now, which really makes those players on the ice more valuable. You can't have a guy who's perhaps one-dimensional. I think teams are just built different. They're living in this cap world and trying to figure it out, and obviously general managers find the need for skilled guys more valuable than those types of players. So I think it's kind of been a natural progression.
During your career, you were a fighter. Would you survive in today's game? Would you have to rework your style of play, rework your repertoire?
I definitely came up at the right time, I think, in the right era. My skill set was still deemed as highly valuable, but I like to think that I could always play the game pretty well, too. I mean, Any guy that has put on an NHL sweater and stepped foot on NHL ice has deserved to be there. They can play the game, there's no doubt about it. Today's game is definitely more than a few steps faster. I would have to think that I'd set my training to be somewhat different to keep up with the pace of play, because it's absolutely incredible the way these guys are playing the game now and the speed at which they're playing it.
Without a doubt, and with less clutching and grabbing and less slashing, you see the beauty of the game, and you see Connor McDavid doing his thing, and you know, so many great players out there. When you watch the game now, what are your takeaways?
I think first and foremost, today's game, you see the youth movement. We've got so many guys who are coming up and making an impact early in their careers, young players who are free to make the plays that we'd like them to play. And these guys have trained more and more at younger ages, making these skilled plays, training the skill side of their games. You mentioned Connor McDavid. He can make plays at top speed more than or better than anybody else I've seen. And other guys are following suit, obviously. But the way in which they're playing the game, the way they're not afraid to make plays and are free to make them with, you know, rules being tightened up on the obstruction stuff, like you mentioned, hooking, holding, slashing. It's all coming together pretty well right now, and we're pretty happy with the way the game's being played.
Players in the NHL are so great about giving back to their communities and being active in important causes. Talk about your relationship and your involvement with childhood leukemia, the fight against that, and all the other different great things that you've done in your career.
As an athlete, you know, you have a great platform and a great opportunity to raise awareness for funds, raise awareness for different causes and funds for different causes. When I was playing, I found a great joy in growing my hair out every year, and probably ticked off a few coaches along the way, but I wouldn't cut it all year long and would ask fans to grow their hair with me and cut it off and donate to the Childhood Leukemia Foundation, clfforkids.org. And had a lot of fun with that. It was a great way to connect to the fan base and endear all of them to a great cause. And so still have the mustache, still do Movember every year, and obviously it's a great way to, again, raise awareness for good causes.
Your legacy, your hockey legacy, like we mentioned, all these great things that you've accomplished and you continue to accomplish. But let's say 20 years from now, what do you want to be remembered for when people look at the history of hockey?
I think I've played a very, very, very small part in it, but at the time being, right now, I do believe that what we do at the Department of Player Safety is crucial to the game, crucial to keeping the game safe, crucial to keeping the players safe and having long careers. And like I said, we make decisions every night. We monitor the game every night to the nth degree to try and serve this game and keep it not only safe, but keep it keep the integrity of the sport. You know, we like our hockey. We like our hockey played physically, but like I said, keep everyone in line, and obviously that's not lost on us. So I think if looking back from this point on, if they were to say that I had a small part in keeping this game played the right way and clean to some degree, then that would be great.
Hey, sports fans. If you want to see more videos like this, check out some of our other ones right here. And if you like what you see, hit the subscribe button and stick around for more from USA Today Sports.